Many of you know that I'm from Southern California, and being from Southern California, we have all kinds of border stories. I mean, I really literally am close, not too far from the border in Southern California, so we have all kinds of border stories. One of the stories that comes out of Southern California is the story of a man by the name of Juan who came to the border on his bicycle with a couple of bags over his shoulders, and the border guard said, "All right, buddy, what's in the bag?" We said this in Spanish, of course. He said, what's in the bag? And Juan says, "Sand." He says, "Show me." So he takes the bags down, puts them on the ground. The border guard cuts them open, goes, dumps them out, and it looks like sand, but he's not sure. And so he's obligated to take it in overnight. He puts Juan under custody, analyzes the sand. In the morning, it's determined it is, in fact, sand. So he fills the bags back up, lets him go. And this happens the next week. Juan comes back. And he says, "Buddy, what's in the sack?" He says, "Sand." And checks it, and sure enough, it's sand. This goes on for 3 years. And then Juan stops showing up. I mean, he comes up. It would come up every day with the sand and the bicycle. 3 years, and then Juan just disappears. And one day, the border guard is in a cantina in Mexico, and he sees Juan at the table sipping on a brew. So he goes over to him and he says, "Listen, this is driving me crazy. I can't sleep. I know you're smuggling something. I don't know what it is. Talk to me. Tell me between you and me, what is it you're smuggling?" Juan sips and says, "Bicycles." Bicycles. There's a genius to that. As we come to Christmas, though, visions of sugar plums are dancing in kids' head, but also visions of bicycles and toys and clothes and stuff. And when we come to Christmas, we are possessed by the reality of the material world. It's all around us. We can't get away from us. And our economy has been just so genius at sort of taking over Christmas with the material aspects. That's why we as Christian men need to realize that Christmas is about Jesus Christ and not about stuff. And that's why new Christians need to know what Christmas is about, and older Christians need to remember. Now, we also know that Christmas is not about babies, is it? Isn't that great? As men, isn't it great to know that Christmas is not about babies? Because frankly, we're not all that excited about babies. Are we? Not really. That's not politically correct to say. When somebody brings a baby up to you and they show you their baby, what is the thing you're supposed to say, guys, if you want to be a good, godly, spiritual Christian? "Oh, wonderful, beautiful baby." I've been a pastor for a long time. People feel obligated to bring to pastors their babies. Look, yeah. And they bring babies to us. Grandparents bring, it's worse when the grandparents bring the babies to us. They bring the babies up and they say, "Look at this baby." And you're going, "Yeah, it's a baby." There are times when, as a pastor, I've wanted to say, "What in the world did that baby run into? What disease does that baby?" I've had people bring babies to me and stuff all over their face. They go, "And what do you say?" You say, "That's a baby. You got to be so happy." Christmas is not about babies. But guys, I want to give you a gift at Christmas, and you will thank me for this. I want to absolve you forever as a man from ever having guilt at not thinking that babies are cute. All right? Today, this Christmas, you are absolved of any guilt. You can just say, "Wow, that's a baby. I bet you're happy." And the subtext is, because that baby doesn't necessarily make me happy. Babies are cute. My babies are cute, and my grandkids are cute. Yours are ugly. And I don't even feel guilty about that. It's just okay. Babies are cute to some. They are proof of the cycle of life. They make parents and grandparents happy. And every one of those little Philistines is proof of the power and miracle of God. That's true. But Christmas is not about babies. Is it? It's about how a baby became a man with an extraordinary life, and more than a man. And so we talked about the reality of Jesus Christ high status last week. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Son of Abraham, the Son of David. And we talked about how his high status affects your status. That because Jesus' status is incredibly high, your status is incredibly high if you're related to him. And it makes all the difference in the world. And so today what we want to talk is about Jesus' extraordinary life. Because Christmas is not about a baby, it's about what the baby did. It's about what he became and what he did with his life. Christmas is a birthday, right? And we celebrate birthdays of very influential people. And that's what Christmas is all about. So I'm going to start today as we talk about the extraordinary life of Jesus. We're going to start today with Matthew 1, 18 through 25. A very familiar text to many of you. If you have your Bibles, turn there. If you don't have your Bibles, trust me on this. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly because, as many of you know, betrothal meant marriage. When you were betrothed, it was legal. You were married. And to get out of a betrothal, you had to get a divorce, a legal divorce. But as Joseph considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. They shall call his name Emmanuel, which means, gentlemen, what? God with us. When Joseph woke from the sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name, because that's what the angel said to call him. Now, his birth was extraordinary. And let me tell you a couple things about that, and then we'll talk about his life. His birth was announced by a very scary, superhuman being. How was your birth announced? I still have my birth announcement. And it was this little paper that they sent out with a stork on it carrying a little baby boy, a cute little baby boy, I might add. And so that was my announcement. All right, maybe not so cute, Bob, but my announcement was that way. Today, a lot of people post the announcement on Facebook. Hey, had a child. Cool. A very scary superhuman being announced the birth of Jesus, showing that an extraordinary event was taking place. Number two, Jesus' birth was from a certifiable virgin, and therefore a once-in-a-world event, the virgin birth. And guys, this is not an optional doctrinal position within the Church of Jesus Christ to talk about the virgin birth. It's not something that we can ever, ever get rid of. It has to be there. Because if Jesus was not born of a virgin, then his sacrifice on the cross could not be for our sins. It could only be for his. And so the virgin birth is mentioned here. That's a once-in-a-world experience. Jesus' birth fulfilled 600-year-old prophecies from the Old Testament. And these are indications of his extraordinary life to come. But it goes on. Walking through Matthew, we go on a text I'm not going to read now, but in Matthew 2, we come to the wise men, and what else happens in that next segment? In Matthew about the birth of Jesus is not only the wise men coming, but the slaughter of the innocents, because Jesus' birth was signaled in astronomical anomalies. I can barely even say that. But there was a star that appeared, right? The birth was unique in that actually what took place in the cosmos translated here. And that was another part of this phenomenal life. Jesus' birth drew international attention by these high-level officials who were what we call the Magi or the Magi. They were astronomers. They were counselors to kings. And this took place within a 2-year period, right? Because it says that when Herod found out about these guys coming to see a king, he sent to Bethlehem and had slaughtered all the babies, the innocents, 2 years and under. So this took place over a long period of time, 2 years. Jesus' birth stirred up the fears of leaders of Israel and the unleashing of evil within Israel, so that Herod went out. Jesus' birth stirred the cosmos. It stirred the political institutions in Israel. It stirred them up so much that it stirred evil. When Jesus was born, it wasn't a nice, sweet little candlelit birth in a cave in Israel. It had international cosmic implications, gentlemen, all indicative of an extraordinary life to come. And Matthew carries on unfolding the extraordinary life of Jesus. John the Baptist, right? Come. John the Baptist can only be explained because of Jesus' birth. And he was a wild man, camel hair clothes, and not those nice, how many of you at Christmas are going to, on a crisp day like this, get out your camel hair jacket? Yeah, right? Some of you say, I threw that away a long time ago. Well, but cashmere or whatever they are, think of John the Baptist, dressed like a wild man and eating disgusting insects. He made the Robertson family look absolutely tame by comparison. But you can't understand John the Baptist. And by the way, he was John the Baptist, not John the Presbyterian. If he was John the Presbyterian, he'd have come in a dark robe with a big cross and looked like he had just sucked on a lemon. He was John the Baptizer. And what John the Baptizer did was, catch this, he precipitated a national revival. Did you catch that? Because that's what he did. John the Baptist can only be explained by Jesus. And when Jesus came, John came, and John, people were coming to John out in the wilderness. Coming down to the Jericho, down to Jericho on the River Jordan, which was only about knee high. So you Baptists, who you think it was this high, are wrong. Sorry. Even back in Jesus' day, the water was only about knee high, and they probably had to get down like this, or if he did this to immerse them, and they probably were immersed, for those of us who are into sprinkling. It wasn't an easy process, but they were coming out to this guy out in the middle of nowhere and getting baptized at all levels of society. Political leaders, religious leaders, common people. This was an international, men, women, and children. On the topic of Jesus coming in his extraordinary life, not only did he precipitate a national revival, he left world-changing teaching, didn't he? The teaching of Jesus has changed the world. And it's going on every day. It's happening here, Key Life Men, with some of the most spiritual men in Orlando, right here. And not so spiritual. Right here. But this is going on all over the world. We think of the topics that Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit. Where's that from? Those are called the Beatitudes. It's from the Sermon on the Mount. How many have heard of the Sermon on the Mount? Yeah, the world has heard of the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are the peacemakers. Cultures have been transformed by this. The golden rule, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And the guy translations, do unto others before they do unto you. No. Prepositions mean everything. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. The Lord's Prayer being said worldwide. Today, as we speak, definitive teaching on money, relationships, marriage, divorce, being in a non-religious relationship with God. Jesus' teaching has transformed the world. Would you agree? What about his miracles? An extraordinary life. Jesus could do miracles, no Doug Henning, David Copperfield, smoke and mirror kind of miracles. When Jesus did a miracle, he could do it on demand at any time he wanted to. Whether the person knew him, had faith in him, or anything. Jesus could do these miracles, water to wine. Peter's mother-in-law, that's a miracle in itself. He healed his mother-in-law. He could have said, this is an opportunity. What's said here stays here, guys, all right? Don't use that at home. You'll get in trouble with that one. He casts out demons. I love one of my favorite healings or casting out of demons is the Gadarene demoniac. That wild man who literally had the power to break chains, and he lived naked out in the tombs, out in cemeteries. And yet when Jesus gets to him, the next thing you find is that he's clothed and in his right mind. Yeah, I love that. The paralytic, lepers, the blind, raised the dead, tax money in a fish's mouth. He's done all kinds of miracles on demand. I believe he's also the most powerful leader that ever lived. He talked to every strata of society and talked down. He talked to Caesar's representatives, gentlemen, and wasn't afraid. Perhaps the greatest point, though, of Jesus' life and what we're getting at and what I want you to catch is how he changed people, listen to me now, from the inside out. Because of all of the extraordinary aspects of Jesus' life, the Bible points inexorably to the fact that he was born to die in his death, burial, and resurrection. And people who have come into connection with Jesus Christ have been changed from the inside out. And that is the key. How did he do that? I just did sort of a survey of Matthew. Now let me do a quick survey of John. You ready? It's not going to be long. In John 1:6, it says, of his fullness, of Jesus' fullness, we have received. That means from Jesus, we had to get something from the outside inside. John 2:29, he's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So Jesus was able to get in us and take away from us what needed to be taken away, i.e. our sin. We have to be born again, the New Testament says, right? John 3. Got to be born again. A Samaritan woman, to the Samaritan woman, Jesus says, you need what kind of water, guys? Living water. You're here to get physical water to drink, but you need living water, not to just satisfy your physical thirst. You need living water to satisfy your soul inside you. That's what you need. In John 6:44, it says that the Father draws you. We have to be drawn by God because we can't just by ourselves get to God. And God's not in us already. He has to be put in us. That's what's crucial. John 8:32, you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free, because before the truth gets in you, you're in bondage. I'm in bondage. Jesus says, I'm the door to the sheep. I'm the entryway to get in. Some of you are saying, where am I going with this? I'll be clear. Jesus says, I'm the vine. If you're not connected to me, you don't have the nutrients spiritually you need for life. Right? In John 16, he says we need to be one with the Spirit and one with Listen, at Christmas, we celebrate the birth of Jesus because of his extraordinary life in his death, burial, and resurrection. And I want you to know of his impeccable status. How because he's the Son of God and the Savior of sinners, and if you're connected to him, you have an incredible high status. But I want you to also know that his extraordinary life, perhaps the pinnacle of that extraordinary life, is how he gets into a man and transforms a man from the inside out. That God has to get into us, and Jesus is the one who does it, who gets into the masculine soul, is proof that we don't have him in us to begin with. And until he comes into us, he's not there. Listen, you've heard that old deal saying you're not a car just because you're in a garage. You're not a Christian. Christ is not necessarily in you until he comes into you. And at Christmas, we need to realize that the exciting thing is not bicycles or babies. It's that Christ has made a transformation in a man's life because he can come into him. And at Christmas time, we're remembering the incarnation. God with us, but also God in us. Christ in us. And that is so, so powerful. And so at Christmas, we need to remember that what Jesus came to do is to tell us that we need to receive him. Because until we receive him, he's not in us. That's why in John 1 it says, as many as received him, to them he gave the right then to become the children of God. Now catch this, Colossians 1:27 says, to them God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We are in to glory because we're men. We're not into babies unless they're ours, but we are in to glory. I am, aren't you? Don't you remember the time you caught the TD, crossed the finish line? I'll never forget. It was Sunday after church. We were playing pickup football with the guys, and I'm the wide receiver, and I catch that sucker. Long pass. It's beautiful. Immediately hit the goalpost right here. Held onto that sucker, though. And they took me to the doctor nearby, and he goes, yeah, you got to get stitches in that. And I'm bleeding like a stuck pig, and what am I saying? Glory. We're into glory. But the reality is that as we pursue glory in life, it's elusive and we'll never get it by ourselves. The hope of glory is from God. It's what God does in us when Christ comes in to us. Have you seen that movie? Quentin Tarantino, Brad Pitt, Inglourious Basterds. Some of you are going, yeah. Some of you are saying, ooh, he cussed. If you're quoting somebody else, it's not a cuss word. See, that's some good biblical theology I want you to get here today. Okay, but catch this. Here's the truth. Because Christ can come into a man, what he does when he comes into him is takes us from becoming inglorious bastards and makes us sons of the living God, but only when he comes into you. And that's the gospel. That's good news. And at Christmas, the baby came so that Christ could come into us and transform us and take us from becoming inglorious bastards and making us beloved sons. I'll bet you in a group this big, there's somebody that has never received Christ. I'll just bet you. A lot of us go to churches, but we've got to receive him. And at Christmas, understand, it's not just about gifts, bicycles, babies, and all that kind of stuff. It's about receiving Christ so that Christ can get in you, because that's the hope of glory. And what I'm hoping is that you, if you're here for some reason, maybe you want to put your marriage together, or you need friends, and those are good reasons to be here. But you need Christ, and that's what we want. Ultimately, what I want for you, what Christ wants for you, is for him to come into you, to receive him. And that's what's important today and at Christmas. To Christians, I want to say to us who are followers of Christ, at Christmas, what our friends need is for Christ to come into them. And it's kind of hard for us sometimes to talk about, do evangelism and talk to other guys about Christ, but that's what they need. They need Christ in them. Our friends are looking for glory. We're looking for glory. But what they need is Christ, isn't it? That's what they need. And that's what we have got. I was sitting at my desk working the other day, and I've got this out my front window there where my desk is at. I've got a hole in the screen this big. I don't know who did it. Some kid with a BB or something. Didn't break the window, just broke the screen. Or maybe it was my wife taking off the screen. I might have done it. But there's a hole in my screen. And an ant got in that hole. And then it's walking around. I could see it. It's starting to heating up. And the ant's kind of scurrying around. I go, I got to get out of here. And he can't get out the hole. He actually almost skirts the hole, comes so close to the hole, but he can't get out. So I come back after lunch, and that sucker's still there. So what do? I get the insect spray and shoot that sucker through the screen, and he dies. It's wonderful. But the reality is our guys, a lot of our guy friends, our brothers, friends, people we know, are just like that ant. They're caught in a lifestyle that is so counterproductive. They need to get out of where they're at. They need help, but they can't. And they're close to it, but they can't get out. And they need us to tell them about Christ. Who can come into them and change them from the inside out, help them become the men they want to be? They need us. And so, guys, some of you are going to get ready to go to Christmas parties and you don't want to go. Go. Go to the office parties that you don't want to go to with the sole purpose of understanding that you're an evangelist ordained by God to have a cosmic conversation with some dude who's like that ant running around about ready to get singed by the son of the world. And what he needs is the Son of God in him. And you might be the one God wants to use to get him out. Because it's Christ in him, the hope of glory that we all need and that he needs. And we're here to help men. And you got to use words. It's not enough. You've heard that expression? I've said it. Preach the gospel, always use words when necessary. No, no, no. You got to live it, but you got to do it. You got to speak it. Because without the words, there's no meaning. I teach a Thursday morning Bible study with L. He's an MMA guy and some other guys, bishops in that one. And so it's kind of fun. L is an MMA guy who sometimes comes here. He could kill all of us. I've seen him take guys down. He's strong. But he was raised, he told me the other day, we were talking about this whole idea of sharing the gospel with people. He was saying, you know, I used to be just that guy that lived it but didn't talk it. And then I realized that you were saying we got to talk it too. And so I started talking it to my friends. And so when we go to lunch, I said, we're going to pray. So now all my friends pray at lunch with me. When we go to lunch, they have to because I can beat them all up. And so now he talks about Christ a lot more. He has got nothing to fear because he can take everybody. But he realized, I got to talk about it. I can't just live it. He says, now a bunch of my friends are going to church. Are you kidding? This Puerto Rican friend of mine who could kill me is telling people about Jesus that I'll never reach. Love the guy. Christ in men, the hope of glory. So we got to tell them, but guys, here, I'm going to wrap this up. To us at Christmas who've been following Jesus for a real long time, Christ in us is still the hope of glory. And at Christmas time, we remember that he came into us and he wants to continue that glorious process of pushing out stuff. So at Christmas time, it is a time for us to realize that we have received him, if you have received him, that he's still in the process of pushing stuff out of our life, isn't he? One guy came up to me after a Key Life Men said, I'm dealing finally with my pornography issues a little bit more. I go, great. That's awesome. None of us here are perfect. This is a hospital room right here. But with the glory of Christ, he wants to continue. What's he doing in your life? And at this point in my life, he's continuing to deepen my marriage. And I have to work on that. He's changing my relationship to my kids and grandkids. He's deepening some of the character issues I thought I had under control, I'm still working on. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christmas is a wonderful time to say, Lord Jesus, you're in me. What are you doing? What do you want to push out? What lusts, what fears, what greed, what anxieties? This is a great time of the year to let him continue to do in us what he wants to do. So I want you to remember Jesus Christ's impeccable status. He accomplished for you sonship. But I want you to also look at his extraordinary life and realize that what he accomplished for you in his life, in his death, burial, and resurrection, is that you and I too could live more extraordinarily. If you're new to Christ, let him continue to shine his glory in there. And by that I mean, listen to what he's doing in your life. If you've been following Christ for a long time and are kind of stalled, What's he saying to you? Sit by the Christmas tree, get some eggnog, and I don't care what you have in it, and say, Jesus, you're my hope of glory. What are you pushing out? What glory do you want to bring in?